Hey everyone, Pastor Kerry here. Thanks for joining me tonight or whenever you may be tuning in to spend a few moments in God's Word. Man, do we need to stay in God's Word these days. We need His guidance, His comfort, His peace, His power. We always need those things, but man, it's becoming more and more apparent every day because we are in a battle. I mean, let's not beat around the bush. You see the title of this message, Battle Ready, because that's what's going on, sometimes in our own emotions, but also there are things raging all around us, playing out in some very obvious ways, but it's also something that goes a lot deeper than that, because the origins of this battle are not in the physical realm. They're not natural. This is a spiritual battle, and souls are hanging in the balance. So for a few moments, I want to take a look at a familiar passage. It's a kind that we can easily overlook when we read it or hear it and say, yeah, I agree, I got it, it's all good. But instead of really taking it to heart and doing something with it, we can easily take it for granted and never really apply it to specific situations in our lives. Because that means being prepared. And our passage tonight in Ephesians chapter 6 is all about being prepared for battle. So if you've got your Bibles here, pick them up. And let's get to Ephesians chapter 6. I want to begin reading in verse number 10. Ephesians 6:10, we're going to read through verse number 18 of Ephesians chapter 6. It says in verse 10, "Finally be strong in the Lord and in His mighty power," not yours, but His. "Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand. Stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take up the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people." Well, let's do that as we begin. Let's pray and ask God's blessing upon our time tonight. Lord, I thank you for the opportunity to get into your word. I thank you that you've given it to us in a way that just pierces into our life. Your Bible describes it as a sword that cuts into us and discerns our thoughts and intents and motives. It makes a difference in the way we live. And I pray that tonight we'd be better people for the time that we spent tonight in your word. Help to take a hold of our lives. And Lord, help us to be ready to do battle in the power of your Spirit. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Well, you might have noticed at the beginning of that passage in your Bible, it might have the heading in Ephesians chapter 6, the armor of God. And it's verse 11, it says, put on the full armor of God. What does that mean to put it on? What does it mean to put on something? I mean, that's a deliberate action. We're preparing for something. We have a purpose. We're getting ready for something. And the occasion always determines what you put on. I mean, if you're going to an award ceremony, you put on something different than you do if you're going to the gym or to work or to school. But in this case, we're getting ready for something very serious, a battle. And so it tells us to put on our battle garments. And that's the armor because we need to be ready for whatever comes our way. We can't go into battle haphazardly or unarmed because we'll be in deep trouble. We can't go into battle without the proper equipment, and we certainly can't engage in effective spiritual warfare on our own strength and ingenuity, or we will face severe defeat every time. We might even be destroyed because this is war. In fact, let's look at the context of this passage and what we're told about the type of warfare that we're in for. What does it involve? Where does it take place? Who are we up against? And verse number 12 really gives that information. It says that we're in a spiritual battle against unseen forces in the heavenly realms. So what does all that mean? It means that we're not in a conventional battle. It's not just a matter of what we think or what we see going on around us. It involves unseen forces, which means that things are not always as they appear. It's not about what we can see. And that means our battle is not with other people. It's not about earthly situations or ideas. It's against spiritual forces of evil that we can't see with our natural eyes. So how does that change our thinking and our approach toward the battle? Well, for one, it means we need to be sober. We need to be aware and alert, because it's things that we just can't pick up by looking around in the natural. And how do we develop that awareness? Through those spiritual disciplines we talk about all the time. By spending time in prayer, getting to know God's voice and knowing what He's telling us and being in His Word, so we gain the discernment about what's going on and how we're to respond to it. Because we can't fight a spiritual war with normal weaponry. Spiritual battles require spiritual weapons and strategies. And another thing we need to keep in mind is that we need to be compassionate. Now, that might sound contradictory to the tone of a battle, but keep in mind, since this battle is not with other people, they're also caught up in the war, and most of them unaware that they could become casualties of that war because they're blind to the truth. So we need to have compassion toward other people, not anger or frustration or fear, but having a compassion. Now, that doesn't mean that we can approach the battle passively or mildly, because even though we don't often see or know what's going on behind the scenes, we can't take a passive posture toward the battle. We cannot simply resort to a defensive mode that says, I'm just holding the fort until reinforcements come. In Matthew chapter 16, Jesus is asking His disciples who they believe He is. And some of them, you know, replied, well, some people say you're John the Baptist, and others Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. But who do you say I am? Jesus asked. And Simon Peter answered and said, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. Now, Peter himself wasn't the rock. Some people have kind of taken that theology and says the church was founded on Peter. It was founded upon that confession in Jesus as Lord, as God's Son, and our Savior. And Jesus said that He would build His church, and the gates of hell won't prevail or hold up against us. Now, sometimes we read that passage of Scripture, I think we kind of put it like it's in a defensive posture that you know, the gates of hell won't prevail against us. It, you know, like the gates are coming against us. I don't know about you, but I've never been attacked by a gate. You know, every once in a while I'd walk through one of those that slaps me on the backside, swings when I come out of it. But this isn't a defensive passage of Scripture. This is talking about that we are advancing into enemy territory. Why? To reclaim what is ours, to rescue souls. And as we advance, hell's forces, hell's gates won't be able to stop us from busting through. But that's only if we're sufficiently armed. And that's what it's talking about in verse number 13. So that when the day of evil comes, that you may be able to stand. Have the armor on in advance. Don't wait until evil presents itself to try and figure out what to do next. Don't be scrambling to get the armor on at the last minute. You already know it's coming. The battle is already in process, so be prepared. And I want to look at the full armor of God, piece by piece, and I want to consider the purpose of each one. So let's look in verse number 14. It mentions the first piece of the armor, and that is the belt of truth. Now, that may seem like, you know, that's not really a battle implement, but what purpose did that belt serve, as he mentions it first here? Well, the belt is not quite like maybe we think of, but there's an element where it kind of holds things up. But this belt and the armor really was something that kind of held everything together. In many cases, the other implements were attached to it. What was on top, what was below, was all hooked in. And the belt just kind of held everything together, but it also held the weaponry. It held the dagger, it held the spear, it held other things that they would use, just like a policeman has all the things on their belt. And so that belt of truth kind of held everything in place. Now, how do we determine what's true to begin with, what's holding truth together? Well, we've got to be in, the Bible says that sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. And that's why in a large part, Satan's greatest strategy was to attack the authority and the authenticity of the Bible. And you see that happening more than ever today, that he's just trying to erode the foundations of that truth. When you get back to whether it be the origins of life or what the Bible means, what it says, or all these things. There's a while back a popular book that was made into a movie that attempted to depict God in kind of a non-conventional way. And it contains a lot of off-base theology. And at one point, it makes a statement that says God can't be confined to a book. And that may sound reasonable. You know, God is more. We got to take out and live it. But that was really a subtle slight on the written word, that it's not just what's there. And maybe it's more than what we see in the Bible. Or, you know, the Bible can't be taken literally. And all these things, because Satan begins to attack those foundations and everything on top of that crumbles. I mean, God can handle questions. His word can and will stand the test of time and scrutiny. It already has more than any other book. But if you allow your faith and the foundation in God's word to be eroded, then that faith is not going to hold up when testing comes. And your life will ultimately come apart at the seams because you haven't held to that truth. And the belt of truth has got to have a hold around you in order for you to be battle ready. Verse number 14 mentions the second thing, and that is the breastplate of righteousness. Now, what does the breastplate cover? What is it really for? Well, it protects your vital organs, primarily your heart. That's what righteousness does. So what is righteousness? Righteousness simply means to be in right relationship with God and to be living in a way that is right by the measure of his word. We talked about his word being truth. Now, it also means to rely on him and not yourself for all of that, because we can't be right in our own efforts, right? Choosing to do things our own way and relying on our own efforts and ingenuity and strength always leaves us vulnerable and susceptible to spiritual attacks. But when we rely on God's word and we respond to that word with action, then we will develop God's character within us, and that will protect our heart. And relying on God for strength, for provision, for guidance, for wisdom, for our very salvation, and doing things his way is what really guards our hearts. In the Psalms, we see how David, who is a person described in the New Testament as a man after God's own heart, David's own writing throughout the Psalms reflects how he delighted in righteousness. In fact, at one point it says, "I run in the paths of your commands." I mean, he was relentless about pursuing and loving God and doing things God's way. And that kept his heart right to the degree that God himself described David as a man after God's own heart, the breastplate of righteousness. The next thing it mentions in verse number 15 is having our feet fitted with the readiness to deliver the gospel. Now, that, you know, having your feet ready and something on your feet for battle, you got to keep in mind, it's tough to go anywhere that our feet don't take us. That's how we get around. It's how we go places. So are we walking in a way that shows that our priority is on God's purposes? And that includes reaching and influencing others for him and living out the gospel in very practical ways, because believing and boldly proclaiming and living out the message and character of Christ is a sure way to advance his cause and to overcome the enemy's tactics and intentions. Because when we're occupied with God's business, we will defeat the devil's business every time. And focusing on our witness and the influence we can have on others for Christ, that will always take us down a path toward fulfilling God's purpose in our individual lives and as a church. If our time and efforts are occupied in promoting Christ's message and his kingdom, then our feet are not going to take us down the wrong path. So are you preoccupied with God's purposes? Are your feet laced up and ready to walk his path for your life? Because if they are, you will have influence on others in a way that points them to Jesus. And that brings us to verse number 16, to the shield of faith. Now, when you picture the shield here, keep in mind that the Roman battle shield depicted here was probably larger and longer than what we might think of often when we think of a shield. Because when crouched down, you could almost conceal yourself entirely behind that shield. And in addition, it was often covered with leather that had been soaked in water to extinguish flame-tipped arrows that were shot by the enemy. And all that symbolizes how our bold faith in God and trust in his word helps us to fend off the enemy attacks. And as the Bible says, to quench the enemy's fire arrows of lies and spiritual attack, because we believe and claim God's promises instead. And the shield kind of differs from other pieces of the armor in that its use was both for offense and defense. As an offensive weapon, it helps us to push ahead through the battle and to knock down strongholds and to quench those fiery arrows. But the shield also helps us defend against doubt and difficulty, because when we don't give in and let those things get the best of us, even when we don't see the end in sight or understand what's going on, that shield of faith helps us fight the battle and to stay strong in our faith in God. And that brings us to verse 17, to the helmet of salvation. Now, it's obvious what a helmet protects. There's a helmet used for a lot of things. In sports, you're riding a motorcycle, you put on a helmet to protect your head, but what's inside the head that needs protecting? Your brain, your mind, the source of all our thinking. So how does salvation affect and protect the mind? Well, from the very outset of our salvation, when we repent and turn from our way to God's, that repentance implies a changing of mind and attitude toward God. And spiritual salvation itself implies a transformation by, as the scripture says, a renewing of our mind. So salvation comes at first as we repent, and as salvation goes on, it transforms and renews the mind and ultimately transforms our attitudes and actions and keeps them in line with God's character. Because salvation is more than just a one-time event. It's an ongoing process. It's a way of life that is continually transforming us into God's image and developing Christ's character in us. It's an ongoing, vital relationship with God. And that helmet literally helps us keep our head in the battle. And that brings us to what really is mentioned is kind of that last weapon, and that's the sword of the Spirit, which it defines right in the passage, verse 17, as the Word of God. Now, I want you to notice what's distinct about that sword from the rest of the armor, and that is that it's the one piece that is primarily a weapon, not just to fend off attack, but literally to be proactive, to be on the offense. Remember when Jesus was fasting in the desert in Matthew chapter 4 and Luke chapter 4, and the devil showed up on the scene to tempt him? You recall how Jesus used scripture to defeat the devil's attacks time and time again? You know, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from God, and you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you serve, and all these things. And Jesus says, it is written, it is written. And how much more do we need to rely on God's word and claim his promises as we do battle against the enemy? And as we pray in faith, the best way to pray to do that is literally to pray the scriptures, because that's God's word, and we're just affirming that. But in order to do that, we need to know the word. We need to know how to use it. And like you see in the movies, when there's a novice who's learning to do battle and they train with the weaponry and they're learning how to use it, they spend time with it, they get to know it, they practice it. We need to do the same thing with the word of God. We need to get in it. We need to learn it. We need to discern how it applies to our lives. We need to put it into practice and to try it out and see how it's going to help us hold up and how it's going to help us do battle and defeat the enemy. I could preach a whole message on that, but I'll leave it at that. And that brings me to the last part of this passage in verse number 18, where it says, pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. And as we close, I want you to notice something about prayer in relation to the whole armor of God. In fact, in relation to the battle in general, notice that reference to prayer kind of wraps up the whole section. It's an all-encompassing issue. It's not depicted just as another spiritual weapon, but instead, prayer is a large part of the battle itself. We literally do battle in and through prayer. It's the way we partner with God himself to gain that victory for him, for others, for ourselves. We do that through prayer. There are things that are literally set in motion that are released in the spiritual realm when we pray, because that's the way God has set it up. There are things that will happen when we pray that won't happen if we don't pray. You may have seen the movie War Room that kind of depicts that discipline of prayer as the means by which we do battle. We engage in that battle, that spiritual battle in the heavenly realms through the prayers we offer in this physical body. If we're not praying, we're not advancing. If we're failing to pray diligently with all kinds of prayers in all situations, like it says, that means we're surrendering to the enemy. We're forfeiting territory to him. And what's at stake if that happens? What's lost if we don't prepare? If we don't engage in the battle? If we don't pray? What won't end up getting done? We won't get the gospel to lost souls. People will be lost forever if we don't stand in the gap and do battle for those who don't yet know Christ. And for those who do follow him, if we're not in prayer, we're going to lose ground. We're going to forfeit victories. Our faith is going to be compromised if we fail to prepare for and engage in the battle, fully armed, fully equipped, and ready to advance God's kingdom, as it says in Ephesians 6, 10 and 11, by standing strong in the Lord and in his mighty power, put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. And so we can reclaim that lost territory and lost souls for Christ. People, the battle is on. We may not see everything that's going on around us, but we can see the evidence all around. And so I'm telling you, get ready, put on the full armor, take up the sword of God's word, pray all the time. That doesn't necessarily mean we have to have an open mouth, but open ears to hear God's spirit and run boldly into the battle as his spirit is guiding us. The Bible says, not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord. We need to be battle ready. Let me pray for you tonight as we close. Lord, I thank you that you've not left us alone in this battle. Lord, you're with us. You're leading the way. And Lord, you've given us a full arsenal of weaponry. I pray that you would help us learn to use that, that every part of it we would put on, Lord, from that salvation that transforms our mind, your righteousness that protects our spirit, the truth that holds it all together, the sword of your spirit, feet ready to take your message to others. God, in every way, I pray that you would help us to be ready, to be prepared in advance. We know what's coming. We know what we're in for. We know what we're in the middle of. The evidence is all around us these days. Help us to be prepared and remember that it's not our power. These are the weapons that you give us. These are weapons that are powerful to demolish those spiritual strongholds. And so, God, I pray tonight that we would go not living in fear, but living in faith. With the power of your spirit, that we will use your weapons, we'll be in your word, we'll know what's coming, we'll know how to use it, we'll be putting it into practice and living in a way that helps us to be victorious in every situation. So we'll give you glory for it all, for you're the one who is worthy. You're the one who makes us overcomers. We thank you for this. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Guys, go into battle boldly, strongly, in the power of God, fully armed and equipped, and have a great week. The Lord be with you.